We can start the meeting.
Am I audible, Vishal?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Today is World Radiology Day. This is to commemorate the discovery of X-rays by Conrad William Rontgen. And we are inaugurating our Andhra Pradesh Telangana SFM chapter. This is our first CME after the inauguration. And on behalf of SFM Andhra and Telangana chapter, I extend a warm, sunny welcome to all of you for this webinar. The concept of this webinar or the capsule presentation is to break the monotony of lengthy lectures and focus on pertinent points. The topics that have been chosen on ultrasound attributes, that is the features, and their clinical relevance, and take it forward, and how are we going to evaluate them in our day-to-day practice. SFM is an academic platform which is actively involved and committed in promoting young talent. As Ashok says, the future legends. Today's faculty is an amalgamation of stalwarts as well as debutants. And my humble request to everyone is to keep the time, that is 10-minute slots. And great presenters are always deliver good content as well as stick to their time. I, on behalf of SMM, Andhra and Telangana chapter, would like to invite my dear friend, Ashok Khurana, a mentor, I call him a visionary, to inaugurate our chapter, and also invite the core committee of SFM, that is Dr. Bimal, Dr. Mohit Shah, Dr. Krishna Gopal, Dr. Sunil Mehta, Dr. Aparna, to be with us and grace this occasion. Over to you, Dr. Ashok, to declare our chapter inaugurated and share few pearls of wisdom. Then I request Aparna Sharma, our dynamic, brilliant academic joint secretary, to a brief account on SFM academic activities. Thank you, and over to you, Ashok.
Hi, a very good morning to everyone, and congratulations, Dr. TLM Praveen, for this wonderful re-initiative. Not that the Andhra and Telangana region has been quiet for over these years. They've been our testing ground for our first trimester quality control program. And of course, we've had a lot of stalwarts as well as new talent coming in from there. There has been technically a fairly academic vibe there, even though we didn't have a formal regional chapter, but I'm so glad to actually declare this open. And my congratulations to the entire team that's going to carry this forward for the next 2 years. And then of course, throw the floodgates open to a lot more talent coming up in the region and all of us learning from each other. I'm so glad you pushed this initiative, and congratulations also for putting together this fantastic faculty for today. I'm really looking forward to some rapid learning of hardcore imaging, and I leave the floor now open to the rest of the gang, as we are called, to take this forward. Congratulations.
Thank you, Ashok. And I would request Dr. Aparna to briefly tell us about the academic activities that SFM has been taking initiatives. Hello.
Unmute yourself, ma'am.
Yes. Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
So, respected Khurana sir, Dr. TLN Praveen sir, esteemed senior faculty colleagues, and dear delegates, on this online conference, a very warm welcome to you all on this Sunday morning. We are looking forward to some stupendous academics during the day. But before we begin, I would like to highlight the vibrant academic atmosphere of SFM. I can only begin by saying that the Central Committee, led under the charismatic leadership of Dr. Khurana and Dr. Praveen, is the most active and is actually the driving force, and which made us all witness the three Sundays with Ravi Choi. I'm sure all of you must have been a part of it, and it was a historic event with historic attendance and appreciation on a virtual platform. But the zest and fervor percolates to each of its chapter, which are around 15 in number, the active chapters who are organizing high-class academic activities, even sometimes with international faculty and speakers, while maintaining their local fervor by involving young talent. And there have been actually more than 50 webinars just during the lockdown with more than 10,000 registrations. And each of these WhatsApp group is active with enriching case discussions. And some of them, every day we are learning. Then there is this Society of Fetal Medicine Postgraduate Program, which is a brainchild of the present mentors led by Dr. Khurana and Dr. TLN Praveen. And Dr. Krishna Gopal and myself have completed one pilot program in RIMS Ranchi and AIIMS Patna with 40 postgraduates and 4 modules with 8 lectures. And another one is being run with Dr. Deva Smita in Kolkata, where the postgraduates are taught the basics of fetal medicine in divided modules. Now, the reason I'm mentioning all this is that I think everyone will agree with me when I say that learning is never ending. And we are definitely inspired by the company we keep. And SFM Shore is great company. So I feel proud to be a part of this family. And with the inauguration of this new chapter, we hope and we welcome another new member to our family. And we hope to see you all very active academically and take SFM to new greater heights. So thank you, everyone, and welcome to SFM family.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Aparna. Now, the floor is open to Mohit Shah to conduct the first session of the program.
Yes, thank you, sir. Good morning, all. Congratulations to Dr. Praveen and the team Telangana and Andhra. What I like about today's programs are the snippets. 10 minutes talks makes it compact and easy to absorb in view of an attention span. And therefore, you can basically it's a perfect amalgamation for stalwarts and debutants. And I'm proud to say we have a lot of debutants today that I'm going to introduce you to. And to begin the first lecture, we have Dr. Upasana Barua from Guwahati. She's a consultant radiologist at Excel Care Guwahati, a very dear friend. And she has a fantastic collection of cases. But more than that, she has a knack of creating beautiful images and beautiful, those artwork on the slides. As you can see, the graphics that you will see of Upasana will be mind-blowing. And she's going to take us through echogenic lungs. Over to you, Upasana.
Thank you so much, sir, for kind words. I'd like to share the screen now. Thank you, organizers, for giving me the opportunity. And just a minute. Can you see my screen? No?
Not yet.
Not yet, Upasana. Share screen.
Yes. Thank you for the given opportunity. And I'll be talking on echogenic lung today. And as we all know, the primordial lung for lung primordium develops from the ventral aspect of the foregut as in endodermal diverticulum around 4 weeks of embryonic period. And it has to undergo 4 developmental stages in fetal phase that ultimately will give us a lot of matured alveoli that will be properly functioning during onset of the respiration. So lung echogenicity indicates lung maturity, and that will changing from hypoiso to hyperechoic in comparison to the adjacent echogenicity with the advanced gestational age. And we must be aware of the artifact that while in routine screening, we can commonly see an echogenic area behind the lung, and that is because of the distal acoustic enhancement of the heart and should not be misinterpreted as an echogenic lung disease. So echogenic lungs are broad spectrum of developmental abnormalities presenting in different anatomical and histological pattern depending on the time and site of origin. And they are rare, detectable in second trimester, very low chromosomal and non-chromosomal syndromic association, and recurrence is none except chaos. We have a list of echogenic pathology there causing echogenic lung syndrome, with the cystic pulmonary airway malformation being the commonest one, responsible for 50 to 75% of echogenic lung disease, and the congenital diaphragmatic hernia being the closest and the commonest differential diagnosis. we do suspect when there is abnormal echocentricity of the lung or there is presence of mass effect over the adjacent area. With the prognosticating factors like volume of the lesion, residual functioning lung tissue and associated abnormalities and onset of complications that to large extent depend on the mass effect of these space occupying lesions that can lead to polyhydramnios, pulmonary hypoplasia and hypertension and the most previous sign, high drops. So the CPAP being the commonest cause developed in the pseudoglandular phase, 6 weeks of intrauterine life, and it contains terribly malformed tissues with hematomatous proliferation, which is devoid of proper alveolar and cartilaginous structure, but they still remain connected to the main bronchial system and supplied from the pulmonary vessels. So we can prenatal surveillance we can do with CPAP volume ratio that will be obtained by dividing the volume of the mass with that of the head circumference in centimeter. And if it is more than 1.6, it suggests poor prognosis with 75% cases developing high drops. And mortality is more than 95 with high drops. On the other hand, survival rate is more than 95 without high drops. We have five histological types described by Stroker, but for imaging purpose, we divided it into three types depending on the cyst size. Type 1 is the macrocystic, 70% the commonest type. As you can see here, we can see a echogenic lesion in the left lung with some cyst of prominent size, with the largest cyst being 2.3 centimeter, which is more than one third of the mass lesion. So we can label it as a dominant cyst size. There is intact diaphragm, mass effect of the upper the heart, and the severe is here 1.02. at 21 week of gestation. So we can label it as a low risk case, but we have to be aware that there is a dominant size, so need a close monitoring because it can rapidly grow in size and can lead to pressure symptoms. Here is another lesion with echogenic segment of lung in the left lung, and it's a smaller cyst, less than 2 centimeter, and it is type 2 CPAP that can be associated with anomalies in 10% of cases, like renal anomaly, cardiac anomaly, or tracheoesophageal fistula. And type 3 CPAP is microcystic, less than 5 millimeter size cyst, and that are not discernible in ultrasound. And it appears as in homogeneous echogenic lesions with mass effect, and it has a high tendency to grow and causing a pressure effect over the mediastinum and heart and the other lung. And essentially, they are all supplied with pulmonary vasculature. So depending on the severity and CPAP ratio, we can schedule a follow-up and the management of the course. So CPAP has a natural course with rapid growth between 20 to 26 weeks, and hence less chance of developing high drops after 26 weeks when it's reached the size plateau. 10 to 20% do decrease completely by third trimester. However, it persists, but it becomes invisible in ultrasound because of increasing echogenicity of the surrounding lung with the gestational age. So next common cause is bronchopulmonary sequestration. It represents a maldeveloped non-functioning sequestrated lung, which embryologically has a complete separate origin below the tracheobronchial diverticulum, and it descends down separately to get its final position. It may be intralobar when it incorporated into the parent lung tissue and has and shared a common pleural lining. But if it develops a little bit later after development of the pleura, then it has its own visceral pleural covering and giving rise to the extralobar variety, which is the most commonest antenatally diagnosed variety. And it in 10 to 20% case, it may lie below the diaphragm. In that case, it is associated with CDH, cardiac, and vertebral anomalies. It is not communicating with a bronchial tree, and it is typically supplied with plants from the aorta, and the variety may have an venous return to the pulmonary vessels. So in ultrasound, we can see a well-defined homogeneously hyperechoic triangular mass lesions with mass effect over the mediastinum and heart, and typically seen in the left lower lobe more commonly. And in sagittal section, when we ensure the mass is supradiaphragmatic in location, and in Doppler interrogation, we can find a feeding vessel from the descending aorta and it ascending up and supplying the mass. And this is the pathognomonic sign of sequestrum. So here is a case of bronchopulmonary sequestration with a very well-defined, well-circumscribed hyperechoic mass lesion at the posterior to the stomach in the abdomen. And it will give in our mind to the differential diagnosis like adrenal hemorrhage, or there may be major epiglottoma or neuroblastoma, but again, the pathognomic sign of single vessel prominent blood supply from the aorta will give us a diagnosis. Prognosis is very good with 95% survival rate with tendency to regress in 50% of cases in third trimester, possibly due to spontaneous thrombosis of the feeding vessels. And additional risk is there, like high output cardiac failure of the fetus due to high blood chanting. And it is prone to develop hydrothorax frequently, secondary to increased venous return. Some lesions do not fit appropriately to either CPM or sequestrum because they are histologically more closer to CPM or remain indistinguishable. But anatomically, it behaves like a sequestrated loop with systemic arterial supply. For example, here you can see a eicogenic lung lesions in the left lung with small cystic areas there simulating type 2 CPM. But on Doppler, we can see a branch from the ciliac artery ascending up and supplying the mask. So they are put together in hybrid lesions. Chaos or congenital high area obstruction is due to atresia. At the laryngeal or tracheal level, it may be caused by whip or cyst. And then we have a bilateral enlarged eicogenic lung, and the alveoli would be filled up with the lung secretions that fail to expel it out. So increasing the thoracic pressure and squeezing of the heart in between and in bursum of the diaphragm. And that is nicely depicted in the ultrasound with bilateral symmetrically enlarged eicogenic lung, heart is squeezed in between. There is fluid-filled distal bronchial tree and in bursum of the diaphragm, usually associated with ascites during presentation because of decreased venous return due to pressure of the inferior vena cava. So prognosis is extremely poor. More than with the early neonatal death is the rule, more than 50% associated with Fraser syndrome. And in that case, recurrence rate will be increased to 25%. If the obstruction is at lower level, at the level of bronchus, then we will have similar features like tracheal atresia, laryngeal atresia, but it is unilateral and causing significant mass effect and pressure over the mediastinum. There will be flattening or and depression of the diaphragm, but proximal is stenosis, poorer is the prognosis. Bronchogenic cyst can be seen around the carina, and they are from the anomalous air pathways that contains non-functioning pulmonary tissue. And in ultrasound, it appears as an hypoechoic mucus-filled cystic lesion, but it may become eicogenic if it is infected. Then congenital lobar emphysema has is a very rare antenatal diagnosis. Histologically, it appears etiology is similar to CPM, but it develops in a later stage in the canalicular phase when alveoli are formed. So it contains normal alveolar tissue, which is over-distended, and it is usually located in the left upper lobe and give a imaging, on imaging, it closely simulating type 3 microcystic lesions, or may contain cyst, as we can see here, and histology is the definitive diagnosis. So whenever we get a eicogenic lung lesion, we must go for a detailed sonogram Doppler at fetal echo to see for cardiac decompensation. If it is isolated, regressing, and stable, we should plan delivery at term. If it is progressive with complications, less than 32 weeks, especially CPAP with a set of high drops, then we can try steroid administration, 12 milligram, 24-hour effort, and it's supposed to reduce the mass size and decrease the height drops. If not, then we can go for fetal intervention, preferably pleural amniotic shunt or cyst aspiration or resection of the cyst and lobe. If it is more than 32 weeks, follow up and plan an early delivery, and we should plan it in a higher tertiary center where the exit and ECMO procedures would be available. Can go for postnatal embolization or feeding of the feeding vessels, but this is not a definitive diagnosis because tissue will be still there, and there may be complications like fever and infection pain. So better to go for resection or lobotomy around 6 months to prevent the complications like recurrent infection, pneumothorax, or this always 3 to 5% chance of underlying malignancy like bronchoalveolar carcinoma. We all know that chaos has a very bad prognosis, and if it is associated with anomalies, go for karyotyping. If positive, we need to counsel the parents and offer termination. Onset of maternal mirror syndrome may be seen. It's because the mother mimics the sickness of the fetus with onset of preeclampsia-like symptoms usually associated with fetal high drops, then we must offer termination to them. The close differential diagnosis that can mimic eicosanoid lung is congenital diaphragmatic hernia, which is the commonest one. And we need to differentiate it because of its high association with chromosomal and non-chromosomal study syndromes. And also has a completely different management protocol. We have many interesting signs to differentiate it from eicosanoid lung. I'll not go to details. I think it will be covered in my next topic. So the other rare differential diagnosis will be lymphangiocele or a cystic hygroma extending to cyst or upper neck, or maybe an enteromediastinal teratomas, or maybe an endless thyroid even. So in conclusion, I like to thank my teachers, Khurana sir, Praveen sir, Vimod sir, and Mohit sir for the guidance and help. And I like to thank my dear friend, Dr. Ruby and Siva for all the supports they give him. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Upasanaras, very well debuted. And your graphics, as usual, mind-blowing and self-explanatory.
Thank you,
sir. Moving on, we all know that measuring lung-to-head ratio and interpreting observed-to-expected LHR makes a tremendous difference to the management in CDH. And to take us through with a clear perspective, we have the young and dynamic Dr. Meenu Batra. She's a radiologist with a passion for fetal medicine, a consultant at Simar Hospitals, Kochi and Edappal. She has a very clear thought process and even a clearer way to put it across that makes her a fantastic orator. I always love to hear you, Meenu. Over to you.
Thank you, sir, for those kind words. I hope I am able to bring out some clarity. And before I start, I think I have to congratulate Praveen sir for the inauguration of the SFM chapter and thank Ashok Khurana sir for always getting us into this academic extravaganzas and making it such a big treat for everybody. So moving on to the topic, we would be discussing over the next 10 minutes about LHR and the observed by expected LHR. We know that these are factors that are used for prognostication of diaphragmatic hernia. Now, the incidence of this problem is around 1 in 2005% live births. But the problem is that even today, the antenatal detection stands to around 60 to 70% because we still do not have a defined at-risk group like how we have for Down syndrome or any other abnormality. Another problem that we face today is that it is an evolving anomaly, which means that if you've had a normal anomaly scan, you cannot negate the fact that you might pick this up later in the third trimester because it forms a part of the spectrum of late onset abnormalities as well. So we know that the non-muscular portion of the diaphragm develops from the septum transversum and the pleuroperitoneal folds, whereas the muscular portion develops from the cervical somites. Also, the posterolateral hernias, that is the Bogdalic hernias, are the ones that are most common, more commonly occurring on the left side as compared to the right. Now, what we need to understand here on this slide is that in diaphragmatic hernia, now hernia, as the term suggests, is you have herniation of the abdominal organs into the thorax. But what we also need to note is that this process of herniation coincides with the process of critical period of lung development, where the bronchial branching and the pulmonary artery development is happening. So as a result, what happens is that there is an increased vascular resistance, there is a reduced surface area that is available for gas exchange, which leads to resultant lung compression and pulmonary hypoplasia. So the most common complications that you're worried about when you have a case of diaphragmatic hernia is pulmonary hypoplasia, which eventually will lead to pulmonary hypotension. And a lot of work has been done to prognosticate the disease, wherein at one point of time, we thought that all these factors, which include the gestational age at diagnosis, the position of the stomach, presence of polyhydramnios, the cardiac ventricular size or the degree of mediastinal shift would tell you what is the prognosis. But what has been realized is that out of all this huge list that we have, the major determinants include the presence of associated abnormalities, especially those related to the heart. So it's important that when you have a case of diaphragmatic hernia, you do a detailed fetal echo, the extent of lung hypoplasia and the position of the liver. And in isolated cases, the most pertinent prognostic factors include looking at the lung size and also looking at the presence of liver herniation. Now, presence of liver herniation is only a subjective assessment that you can do on ultrasound because the echogenicity is very similar to the neighboring lungs and the bowel. But what we are going to do today is how do you estimate the lung size? Because that is what is going to help you in predicting what is the perinatal mortality or morbidity. So this was further reiterated in these two articles that came in the White Journal. And to talk about lung head ratio, we know that it is the lung area that is measured on the side contralateral to the hernia, and this is divided by the head circumference. Now, initially when the lung head ratio was developed, we were not having the normal ranges for the lung area. And so what they did was they divided this with a fetal biometric parameter, which was not affected by the disease. And that's how the HC became the denominator. And this is how you would measure in the four chamber view. You measure the lung area on the contralateral side divided by the HC and you would get the LHR. Now, what they said was that over a gestational period of around, it was a constant factor. So you're measuring the contralateral side of the hernia. So the more amount of contralateral lung you have, better would be your prognosis. So when you had an LHR of more than 1.4, there was a 100% chance of survival. In cases of 1 to 1.4, you would have a 60% chance of survival. And when you had an LHR of less than 1, these fetuses would do quite bad. But what happened was that in 2005, Peralta et al., they tried to look at the normal lung areas and tried to form normograms in fetuses between 12 to 32 weeks of gestation. And they looked at approximately 650 fetuses. And they found that against the fact where we believe that LHR was a constant value, LHR was actually increasing as the gestation progressed. And if you look at the lung area, it was increasing at the rate of 4 times more than the head circumference. And therefore they concluded that using a constant value of LHR would not be practically feasible over a gestation, and therefore you should be replacing it with something. So that is when came the implementation of O by E LHR, what is called as the observed versus expected lung head ratio. So where what you do is you divide the observed LHR on the contralateral side by the expected or the median range gestational age expected LHR into 100. Now the sensitivity of this has been postulated as 46% with a false positive rate of 10%. So now coming to measuring of LHR, which is a cumbersome task, most of us find it difficult. Now there are various ways in which you can measure the lung area. As you can see here, I have put three images. In the first image, you can see you can measure the lung area by using a manual tracing method. Or what you can do is you can take the longest diameter and multiply it with the perpendicular dimension. Or you can take the AP diameter at the level of the midclavicular line and you take the perpendicular dimension. Now, they've said that the manual tracing is one of the best method, and I will tell you why. Long ago, when we were very small, we've learned how to measure the area. So if you look at these two images, if it's a rectangle, I can take length into breadth and I know I will get the correct figure. But if you look at the second image, which is an irregular shaped object, I try to implement the same formula of area, what will happen is I am not going to get the correct estimation of the area of this irregular shaped object. So to get the area of this irregular shaped object, what I try to do is I take a trace because that gives me a more accurate estimation of the area. The same principle applies to the lungs. We know whether it is the right lung or it is the left lung, it is not a rectangular shaped structure in the fetus. They have a pyramidal shape. So definitely manual tracing is one of the best methods when you're trying to measure the lung area when you're looking at the O by E LHR. Also, what they found was when you use the longest or the AP diameter method, you in fact end up overestimating the O by E LHR and therefore would falsely counsel the patient with a much more better prognosis than it actually is. Also, this was an article that came in the prenatal diagnosis where they've actually tried to bring about a standardized protocol when you're trying to evaluate fetuses with diaphragmatic hernia, but they've laid practical guidelines when you try to measure the O by E LHR. So what you do is to measure the lung area, it is important that you get the axial plane wherein you can see the four chamber view of the heart. Now, ideally, to get the lung area by manual tracing most accurately, it is important that the contralateral lung should be the one that is nearest to the transducer. Once you've measured the lung area by the manual tracing method, what you do is you divide this with the head circumference And then this observed LHR needs to be divided by the expected to get what is the percentage. You have various calculators available. You can go to perinatology.com or you can go to the total trial website where you have calculators wherein you just have to put the values that you get and you will get the O by E LHR automatically. You don't have to sit and do the math on your own. But sometimes measuring the lung area can be difficult, especially when you have the herniation of the stomach around grade 3 to grade 4. The left atrium can get pushed along and therefore achieving the four chamber view can get very, very difficult. Also, we know that lung and bowel have a similar echogenicity. So most of the times when you have a static image, it becomes difficult for you to understand which is the lung and which is the bowel. So it's always important that you have a dynamic view, a clip that is stored with you, you know, to make sure that you are able to accurately differentiate between these two structures. So just taking you through a few examples, I mean, this was a baby that came to us at 20 weeks. And what you see is a left-sided diaphragmatic hernia. The O by E LHR in this case was around 26%. The patient did not do any investigations and decided to terminate the pregnancy. There's another patient which actually came to us last week. We really had a tough time because the only thing that was herniated and was causing the mediastinal shift was this liver. And I think it was because of the high-end equipment that we had and the position of the baby that we were able to finally appreciate the difference in the echogenicity. The O by E LHR in this case was around 70%. Now, even though I'm talking about O by E LHR here, what you need to note in all these videos or clips that I have shown you is the gestational age is only 20 weeks. So the next question arises is when do you do your O by E LHR? We know it is a gestational age independent fact prognostic marker. But what you need to understand is to be able to prognosticate diaphragmatic hernias most accurately, it is important to measure this prognostic marker at around 22 to 28 weeks. Best is if you can do it between 24 to 26 weeks and then accordingly counsel the patient regarding the prognosis of the disease. Now, on the basis of O by LHR, if it is less than 15%, which tells you that the contralateral lung is very, very less, the chance of survival is almost nil. Less than 25% are the severe cases and the chance of survival is just 15%. 26 to 45% is the moderate category. And if you have an O by E LHR of more than 45%, it indicates a good prognosis. Irrespective of the fact whether your liver is up or down, the same has also been shown in this slide. And in right-sided diaphragmatic hernias, when you have an O by E LHR of less than 45%, it indicates a dismal prognosis, although the number of cases that we see generally of right-sided diaphragmatic hernias are comparatively much, much lesser. So if you look here, what we've understood till now is that an O by E LHR of less than 25% in cases of left diaphragmatic hernias tells you that the prognosis is dismal as opposed to an O by E LHR of less than 45% in right diaphragmatic hernias, which tells you that probably right diaphragmatic hernias have got a more worse prognosis. But then to conclude that, we need much more stronger studies to come in and say that right diaphragmatic hernia cases would be doing worse than the left ones. So I think the key points that we need to take home today is when you have a case of diaphragmatic hernia, once you find that there are no associated abnormalities, the most important prognostic factors are the measurement of the O by E LHR and subjective assessment of the liver herniation. Now, as far as the measurement of O by E LHR is concerned, it has to be done somewhere around 26 weeks so that the exact prognostication of the disease is possible. With severe cases, this option is not available to us at present, but yes, it would be there would be an option probably in the future to select them for fetal therapy trials. And when done in the right way at the right time, it will help you to guide the prenatal counseling of your patients much, much more accurately. Thank you.
Wonderful, Dr. Minu. Again, a wonderful presentation from your side. Clear concepts, absolutely brilliantly put.
Thank you, sir.
I now invite Dr. Alpana Joshi. She is a senior consultant radiologist in Shobha Diagnostics, Malad, a Politburo member of the Mumbai chapter of Indian Radiology and Imaging Association, but a fantastic teacher. Though she does everything, she has special interest in obstetric ultrasound, but she's a fantastic teacher. I have learned and I keep learning still from her a lot. and she's going to talk on pulmonary tract dilatation. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Mohit, and congratulations to Andhra and Telangana team for that inauguration. Can you see it?
Yes, ma'am, we can.
You can mind.
You can
start. So we start with our topic of today of urinary tract dilatation. So it is a general term which will encompass everything, all the obstructions from the level of kidneys, ureter, and the bladder dilatations. So generally what we learned, what we remember from our residency days probably is that we always take up AP diameter of the renal pelvis, and we say in second trimester till about 24 weeks, 4 millimeters is normal, then 7 millimeters is normal, and in the third trimester, we say till 10 millimeters is normal. But the AP diameter is a very dynamic parameter, and its measurement is very variable and misleading due to different renal pelvic configurations, bladder filling, etc. So it does not really consider the calyceal dilatation and the quality of the parenchyma, in fact, which is more important for the prognostication. So we will consider the other parameters which are important in case of urinary tract dilatation. But first, let us see how do we take that AP diameter, because by far the most important and the first thing what we take is the AP diameter. So it has to be taken in a transverse section and not in a longitudinal or in a sagittal section. As you can see here, everything will look little dilated if you're taking it in the longitudinal section. So you should always take it in the transverse section. Between 16 to 27 weeks, we say less than 4 millimeters is normal, and more than 28 weeks, less than 7 millimeters is normal. Ideally, whenever you're taking the measurements, the spine should be at 12 o'clock or 6 o'clock position so that there is no distortion. And as you can see here, you will see one kidney properly, but the other kidney you have to struggle and you need to angulate the probe, and then there is some distortion and you don't really get the correct measurement. So ideally, before giving it as dilatation, you should always have the spine at 12 or in 6 o'clock position. So the Society of Fetal Urology, they have these grading system if it is only the AP diameter, if you consider. And they call it as mild, moderate, severe dilatation of the pelvis. So in the second trimester, the mild is for the AP diameter between 4 to 7, moderate is 7 to 10, and severe is more than 10 millimeters. During the third trimester, the AP renal pelvis diameter will be mild is 7 to 9, moderate is 9 to 15, and severe is more than 15. And then, of course, as we said, that it is not just the AP diameter or the dilatation of pelvis which is important. We need to consider the other parameters. So what are they? The SFU has graded it into, see, the grade 1. Grade 0 is, of course, the normal. In grade 1, it is the sinus is slightly open. So you need to see it in transverse and in the sagittal or a longitudinal section. In 2A, there is the intrarenal pelvis which is dilated, something like this. The intrarenal portion of the pelvis is dilated, and 2B is when you see it, more dilatation, and even the extrarenal portion of the pelvis looks dilated, and the major calyces are dilated, something like this. Then in grade 3, even the minor calyces will become dilated, and in grade 4, the parenchyma will become very thin. Then again, there are pros and cons for each grading system. In SFU grading system, we say that it is a subjective assessment. Grades will vary between different operators. It becomes a little difficult to judge it. Different operators will judge it differently. So it is not very popular other than in the pediatric urologist. Especially one point which is said against it is that the major calyces are dilated and minor calyces are dilated. So in pregnancy, in antenatal life, say if you are scanning between say 20 weeks, 24 weeks, it becomes a little difficult to really differentiate between the major and the minor calyces. So there is another system which is amenhydronephrosis grading system, or for the urinary tract dilatation system. Again, mind you, the SFU, ONEN, they all take into consideration the antenatal and even the postnatal. They always want to correlate both the things. So what Onen classification is about grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, and grade 4 again. But what they have taken into consideration is renal pelvic dilatation alone. Then there is calicial dilatation also. But then, mind you, here the medulla and the cortex are all normal. Again, what they consider AP diameter is not important. Here, the medulla is short and thin, as you can see here in grade 3. And there is the parenchymal thickness, which if you take in second trimester is around 2 to 5 millimeters. And in third trimester, 2.5 to 6 millimeters. That should be taken as normal. Anything less than that will be thinning. Corticomedullary differentiation is normal. And in grade 4, as you can see, there is no medulla. You know, these minor calyces, in fact, are effaced. And there is a lot of parenchymal thinning. So what you call as thinning in the second trimester, less than 2 millimeters. And in the third trimester, less than 2.5 millimeters. And of course, there is no corticomedullary differentiation. And these findings are the ultrasound images. So again, they have, you know, sort of try to correlate what is the SFU grading and how it corresponds to the Onen alternative grading. Then again, there are pros and cons for the Onen system itself. So what was done was in 2014, there was a consensus statement, a multidisciplinary consensus statement on the classification of prenatal and postnatal urinary tract dilatation, what is typically UTD and what is the today's topic of urinary tract dilatation. So there were a lot of participating societies all tried to collaborate in together and give their inputs, give their grading systems, give their studies, different meta-analysis was done. And they tried to propose a unified description of the UTD that could be applied both prenatally and postnatally so that everybody is talking the same language. And a standardized scheme for the perinatal evaluation of these patients based on the sonographic criteria. So their recommendation first was regarding the terminology. So they said avoid non-specific terms like hydronephrosis, mild pyelectasis, pelviectasis, or ureteronephrosis, or just a fullness or the prominence of the PC system, and just use one term, urinary tract dilatation. And then you further determine the severity depending on the specific sonographic findings. Then, of course, the consultation and communication of information. So the sonographic findings should be described in accordance with the recommended grading system. We will see that. And if you feel that there will be immediate postnatal intervention needed, then a consultation with a pediatric urologist or a pediatric nephrologist prior to the delivery should be arranged. Then coming to the specific classification system, the overall classification and of course the severity of UTD is based on following parameters, which are in fact very important, which we have to mention it in the reports. So of course, first is anteroposterior renal pelvic diameter, the calicial dilatation, renal parenchymal thickness, renal parenchymal appearance, bladder abnormalities, and ureteral abnormalities. And of course, it is stratified based on the gestational age. So how do we decide, how do we judge it? Anteroposterior diameter, yes, it is in millimeters, measured in transverse abdominal section. Calicial dilatation, major calyces and minor calyces, yes or no. Again, at around 20, 24 weeks, it may be difficult to differentiate between the major and minor calyces. So that always should be kept in mind. The parenchymal thickness and appearance is abnormal or normal. The thickness is subjective assessment. Of course, when you feel it is thinned out, you should measure it. You should evaluate the echogenicity, corticomedullary differentiation, and look for the presence of cortical cysts. Ureters, again, normal or abnormal. Dilatation of ureter is considered abnormal. However, the transient visualization of the ureter is considered normal postnatally. So for antenatal, we should remember that if you see the ureter, it is dilated and it is considered as abnormal. Bladder, again, you have to evaluate the wall thickness for the presence of ureteroceal and for a dilated posterior urethra. And of course, what we always look for in cases of obstruction is for the emptying of the bladder, which should be seen. So with this, they have stratified it into two groups. That is low risk and high risk. Again, in both the categories, there are two gestational age periods, less than 28 weeks and more than 28 weeks. So these are the renal parameters in low risk category, and these are the renal parameters in high risk category. And then, of course, all these findings are normal, and any of these findings which are abnormal, which will make it to straightaway increased risk of the postnatal intervention or the increased risk of the obstructive neuropathies. So suppose you see a patient at 30 weeks, and if you see that the diameter is around 8 millimeters of the renal pelvis. So what do you think? When it is 30 weeks, more than 28 weeks, and dilatation of 8 millimeters, you will put it as in low risk category. But if you see any of these parameters, say suppose you see parenchymal appearance, which is abnormal, then even though the AP diameter is small, you will still put it straightway into the UTD of A2 or 3. A stands for prenatal, and when they make it UTD P, they actually calculate or they actually say about the postnatal appearance. So you will not then talk about UTD 1 as a low risk just because the diameter was fitting into this category. So that should be remembered. So as you will see here, this is a 20 weeks and this diameter is 8 millimeters. So what we saw in our previous section, that the 8 millimeters and less than 28 weeks, straightway it will make you to UTD increased risk. Then if you see at 32 weeks, the dilatation is 7 and 6 millimeters. But then when you make it longitudinal, you will see that there are these calyces which are dilated. So that means again, this will be at the increased risk. If you see it at 20 weeks, this dilatation is not much, but there is increased echogenicity of the renal cortex. So again, that will put this baby at the high risk UTD A2 to 3. So in the report, which is again a very important aspect of our antenatal reports, what should be mentioned? You should always write about entero-posterior renal pelvis diameter, calyceal dilatation, parenchymal thickness normal or abnormal, parenchymal appearance normal or abnormal, ureters, bladder, and any unexplained oligohydramnios. I mean, oligohydramnios may be because of uteroplacental insufficiency. It may be some other different reasons, but if you know that oligohydramnios is probably just explained on this urinary tract dilatation, then it is of concern. So whenever we are writing the report, of course, the weeks of gestation is always there in the first page. So fetal urinary tract dilatation noted bilaterally or unilaterally, whatever. The AP diameter of right renal pelvis is so-and-so, left renal pelvis is so-and-so. There is no calyceal dilatation at this stage. Renal parenchymal thickness and echotexture is normal. Ureters are not dilated. Bladder is normal. You should look for emptying of the bladder whenever you see any dilatation or any abnormality of the bladder wall thickness. The amniotic fluid volume is normal at this stage, and in the impression, then you write it as the intrauterine gestation of 20 weeks with UTD of A1, and then you say at low risk. And then, of course, there will be a follow-up, which is then recommended. So if you come to the etiology, if you see, you will see that most of the times it is the transient or physiology. So that is 50 to 70% incidence. Then the PUG obstruction, the vesicoureteral reflux, VU junction obstruction, then multicystic dysplastic kidney disease. In fact, you see this as a dysplastic kidney, but the cause is ureteral obstruction sometimes. Posterior urethral valves and all these other things which are uncommon findings. So this is generally about the etiology. So what you can generally go by the rule, as dilatation only involving kidneys, it is most of the times PUG obstruction. Dilatation involving kidneys and ureters, it is VUG obstruction or VU reflux, mega ureter or a duplet kidney. Dilatation involving kidneys, ureter and bladder will be PU valves, megacystis, microcolon, hypoperistalsis syndrome, urethral atresias, cloacal anomalies, etc. So let's go through a few of the examples. So this is just a dilatation and PUG obstruction. You can see that there is calyceal dilatation and there is parenchymal thinning. if you see this actually the dilatation at 28 weeks was within normal range, but the bladder looked persistently distended. And then suddenly, if you see that this dilatation has increased, and if you see, yes, the bladder has emptied. And in fact, this gives you a clue that maybe there is a reflux, and that's why once the bladder is empty, there is sudden increased dilatation of the pelvis, which is noted. This baby followed up with us postnatally also, and there was bilateral VUR, which was treated in time, and this baby is doing extremely well. This is again the ureteral dilatation. This was unilateral. There was a hydronephrosis. There was thinning of parenchyma. And this was, again, you can't really say whether it is reflux or VU junction obstruction, but the obstruction is at the level of VU junction. That is what you can see. This was, in fact, a polyhydramnios and grossly distended bladder with hydronephrosis, hydroureter, and in a female child. So PU valves type of a symptoms of the findings in a female child, it is megacystis microcolon hypoperistalsis intestinalis syndrome. And this was the baby. In fact, this died on day 15 of life. There was nothing much that can be done in these fetuses, in these babies. So whenever you see any pelvic alveolar dilatation or UTD, what you should look at is the ureteral dilatation. If there is, it is not there, it is PUG obstruction. If there is dilatation, then you look for the bladder dilatation. If there is no bladder dilatation and it's only ureters and PC system, then you know that the obstruction is at the VU junction. If there is a bladder dilatation, see if it is a moderate dilatation or a severe dilatation. If it is moderate dilatation, sometimes the bilateral VUR gives rise to this. And if it is a severe dilatation, most of the times it is because of PU valves or MMIHS syndrome. So just to complete the list, we will look at the first trimester urinary tract dilatations, though we don't see it very often. It is diagnosed just as megacystis, but bladder and kidneys are consistently seen beyond 12 weeks only. TVS is better to look at the kidneys. Transabdominal, of course, the bladder is seen beyond 12 weeks. So what we consider is the longitudinal length of less than 7 millimeters is considered as normal for the bladder. And as you can see here, this is almost 13 and a half weeks. So you can see the kidneys and the PC system also. And this is the bladder here. Measurement of renal pelvis cutoff in first trimester is not very well documented. There's one study which just says that 1.5 millimeter is the cutoff which should be considered. But in first trimester, megacystis is something which is more significant, which we tend to diagnose. So you should take it as the midline sagittal plane, and the craniocaudal dimension should be taken, and it should be less than 7 millimeters. So anything more than 7 millimeters will be considered abnormal. When it is between 7 to 15, the chromosomal defects are more common. If it is more than 15, the obstructive uropathy is more common. So you should always remember that if it is between 7 to 15 millimeters where chromosomal aberrations are known, if you rule that out, and if the chromosomal report is normal, then spontaneous resolution is also known. So you can just call these mothers, say at around 16 weeks, and then scan again and look for these dilatations. So in the end, what is very important once you see the urinary tract dilatation is the uniform reporting pattern. If I report it, if you see it, or if a pediatric surgeon is trying to go through the report, everybody should convey and understand the same information. And that's why the checklist is very important. Obstruction at which level? Grossly at the level of kidneys, at the VU junction, or at the bladder outlet should be always looked for and mentioned. Exact etiology may be difficult. Of course, if it's PU valves and you see a keyhole deformity, you will be sure. If it is something like megacystis microcolon syndrome, in the settings of polyhydramnios, we are more sure of the diagnosis. But every time at the VU junction obstruction, you may not be able to give that etiology. Prognostication depends on not just AP diameter, but calyceal dilatation. In fact, many studies say that the calyceal dilatation and the parenchymal morphology are the two most important factors. Of course, the amniotic fluid, especially in the third trimester when you have to take a decision of delivering these babies early, you know that this is PUVALS and you're just following it up. So you want to decide when the kidneys, when there is amniotic fluid less, when the kidneys start becoming a little bright in ecotexture. In fact, you should not allow it to become dysplastic, because even then, when you deliver these babies, many of them land up with renal transplants by the time they are into their age group of 8 to 10 years. So you have to avoid that. So you should look at the morphology of the parenchyma very clearly. And of course, you should remember that not all UTDs are obstructions. There are chromosomal abnormalities, genetic syndromes. So a search for additional abnormalities is a must. Pyelectasis is considered as a soft marker. We all know that the likelihood ratio for isolated finding is 1.08. And another important thing is for the follow-ups. All these babies, when they come for a postnatal follow-up, you should tell them that they should not come immediately on day one of life. They should in fact postpone the ultrasound to beyond 48 hours. Only then you start seeing the dilatation properly, because there is initially oligemia in the early initial 2 days of neonatal life. And of course, even though it is normal at 48 hours or on day 7 of life or even at 1 month, you should repeat one sonography before 6 months to say that this is completely resolved or this has progressed. Then of course, depending on UTD1 or UTD2-3, you can alter your follow-up intervals. Normally, when we see just a dilatation, we tell them to come for a follow-up after 4 weeks. But depending on the extent of dilatation and the parenchymal abnormalities, we call them for a more frequent follow-up that will be altered depending on the findings of the renal parenchyma. So that was all. We really can't go into details of urinary tract obstruction causes, but a general approach for the urinary tract dilatation whenever you see anything is more important. So thank you very much. Thank you, Mohit, and thank you, Team Andhra, for giving me this opportunity.
That was a fantastic lecture, ma'am. You could summarize such a huge topic in 10 minutes with such clear diagnostic flowcharts, talks usually about your rich experience. Thank you, ma'am. And moving on, an echogenic kidney is the most often faced clinical dilemma. First of all, is it echogenic? And if it is echogenic, how do we counsel? And to take us through, we have another debutant, the Dr. Prashant Patil. He is a Politburo member of the SFM. But more than that, apart from his academic interests, he's a great social worker. He has a lot of social interest in and around Kalyan area. And now he's recently been chosen as the IMA president of Kalyan, and he's going to take us through the fetal echogenic kidneys. So over to you, Prashant. Prashant, can you hear me? You can start now. Unmute yourself.
Thank you, Mohit, sir. First, I would like to congratulate Dr. TLM Praveen sir and his team for the inauguration of SFN Andhra Pradesh and Telangana chapter. Today, I'm going to talk about ultrasound pathology, which is frequently seen in our day-to-day practice, fetal echogenic kidneys. As we all know, fetal kidneys appearance is different in all three trimesters. In first trimester, around 12 weeks, fetal kidneys look like two hyperechoic paravertebral structures. In second trimester, the echogenicity of the kidneys are relatively less as compared to the first trimester fetal kidneys. In third trimester, the kidneys are well developed and corticomedullary differentiation is very clear.
If you click on your PowerPoint, it will move.
Yeah.
Click once on the PowerPoint, you'll get your next slide.
Prashant, can you hear us?
Yeah.
There you are. Yeah.
Measuring kidneys is very important in our routine practice. the long axis of the kidneys usually correlate with the gestational age. As you can see in the first image, the long axis of the left kidney is 1.7 centimeter, which corresponds to the gestational age of 17 to 18 weeks. In third trimester also, the long axis of the right and left fetal kidney we have measured, it is 3.6 and 3.5 centimeter, which is corresponding to the gestational age. So long axis measurement of fetal kidney usually corresponds to the gestational age. To label kidneys echogenic, we should compare the echogenicity of the renal parenchyma to the echogenicity of liver or spleen. In the first image, you can see normal sized kidneys with the normal echogenicity. But in the second image, you can see the kidneys are brilliantly echogenic and enlarged. And definitely these are echogenic kidneys. There's a huge list of conditions which are associated with echogenic kidneys. The first group is cystic renal disease, which covers autosomal recessive polycystic renal disease, multicystic dysplastic kidneys, autosomal dominant polycystic renal disease, obstructive uropathies like posterior urethral wall, urethral atresia, aneuploidies, which include trisomy 21, 18, and 13, cytomegalovirus infections and candida attribute to echogenic kidneys, syndromes like Meckel-Gruber, tuberous sclerosis, Bardet-Biedl syndrome, Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome are associated with echogenic kidneys. Physiological variation is an important variation for echogenic kidney, which can be a normal. Unusual causes like renal vein thrombosis, congenital nephrotic syndromes also have echogenic kidneys. On ultrasound, when we see an echogenic kidney, first it is our duty to confirm it is really echogenic. If you are in doubt, use higher frequency transducers. See for unilateral or bilateral involvement. See for the presence of cysts, their morphology, and the fluid echo texture. Measure the kidneys. Visualization of urinary bladder is very important. Assessment of amniotic fluid. Study for other genitourinary abnormalities. Look for other fetal structure for other anomalies. Ask for a relevant family history. This algorithm will help you in differential diagnosis of hyperacute kidneys. If you see an hyperacute kidney and the renal volume is increased and shows macrosis, you should definitely think for multicystic dysplastic kidney. If the hyperacute kidney shows increased renal volume, polycystic kidneys comes in mind, and if the polycystic kidneys are associated with extra renal anomalies, especially central nervous system and skeleton, then your kidney anomaly is definitely a part of well-defined syndrome like Bardet-Biedl, Beckwith-Wiedemann, Meckel-Gruber, Perlman, Zellweger syndrome. If the hyperacute kidney is of normal size, then you should think for a variant of the normal kidney development. If the hyperacute kidneys are small in size, the first thing what clicks in your mind should be cystic dysplasia. Coming to some conditions, autosomal recessive polycystic kidney disease. Here the kidneys are bilaterally involved, they are enlarged, the reniform shape is maintained, corticomedullary difference is completely lost, urinary bladder is not visualized. Oligohedonias moderate to severe is marked from second trimester. It is associated with liver fibrosis. Prognosis is very poor because of associated severe pulmonary hypoplasia. If you see the image, in the first image, by using regular convex probe, we can see bilateral involvement of the kidneys. They are enlarged, brilliantly echogenic. But what high frequency transducer do help us? If you scan with high frequency transducer, you can see the kidneys are showing tiny cysts which were missing on the convex probe. So all echogenic kidneys should be scanned with high frequency transducer probes. In multicystic dysplastic kidneys, kidney involvement is unilateral, they are echogenic, enlarged, reniform shape is lost. You can see multiple non-communicating renal cysts. Urinary bladder is visualized. AFI may be normal or mildly less. In autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease, bilateral involvement is seen, kidneys are enlarged. Kidneys are echogenic, but the echogenicity is predominantly in cortical region, because the microcyst formation is restricted to the cortex. Hence, the corticomedullary differentiation is preserved. Urinary bladder is seen. Amniotic fluid is usually normal or mildly less. You should ask for the cystic renal disease in parents. In the images, you can see the cysts are predominantly more in the cortical region. Obstructive cystic dysplasia. The commonest cause is the lower urinary tract obstruction, LUTO. Kidneys are bilaterally involved. They are echogenic, but they are small size. You can see multiple renal cysts pericortical in patient. Urinary bladder is significant.